Welcome back to The Business Show. Now, working as husband and wife on a business can be very tricky depending on the kind of business you're doing. In our last part of our trip to Itungo Farm in Wakiso, the director's wife shares how she loves working with her husband, and she is actually an accountant on this particular farm. How to make money.
This is coriandra, and this is one of the best forage trees. It has got many advantages. First of all, it has got high protein, up to 22%. It can be used as hay for rabbits, for goats, for chicken, for cows. It can also be used as a windbreaker. If you have banana plantation, you can put in the side. It is also fixes nitrogen in the soil, okay? Fixes nitrogen in the soil. The bees, they like nectar from this, okay? You can use as firewood from this. We have seen that it can be as a shed, used as a shed. So many, I would actually encourage farmers to plant this, one of the best forage trees. One of the best for it. The protein content is here, is 7 to 15 tons, 20-25%, that is protein content. So this one is one of the best. You cannot do dairy, you cannot do cattle rearing, goat rearing without having this. This is what you cut. Okay.
So when you cut that, what do you do?
Now you're going to dry it.
Okay.
You can also feed after wilting the cows will eat this one. The cow will eat this one, okay? Mm. Now this is the food. But again, you can also do what? Wilt it. Wilt it and make hay, what they call leaf hay, out of this. We have already seen the advantages. So this one, I was just showing you how you. If you turn around, you're going to see the pak chong.
Now this. The big pak chong now.
Now this is the grown-up pak chong. This is the grown-up pak chong. But now this one, it has overgrown. Now this one is not good for feeding cows, rather this is for the seed. Why? The protein has shifted from these leaves and they are making the stems.
Yes.
And most of the animals, they don't eat
the stems,
they eat the thing. So now this is the grown up super napier. This is the good stage now. This is the good stage where you should cut and feed the animals. Why? It is still young. The protein is still in these leaves, and it's 1 meter, just between 1 meter to 4 feet. This is the good stage now, where you should cut and feed the cows. The super napier is one of the best. It grows very fast, good for silage. Yeah, and it has got high protein content compared to other napier family.
Okay.
So this one for silage. Yes, this is Guatemala. It's good, it's a good grass, but it has got less nutritional content. Why am I promoting it if it has nutritional content? It's a body filler. It's a body filler. You chop in a small area,
okay,
and you fill your stomach on top of supplement. But it's good also for those who are in a wetland, who are, you know, your land, you normally get a lot of water, and you want something that can be edible, then this is a grass.
Okay.
I want my dear farmers to learn the difference between why you should plant the protein and carbohydrates. It's like you have a smaller land, smaller acreage of land. So instead of planting proteins, then here you go for, you mix them together. Mix the protein, this is glycine, and inside there is centrosema. This one is centrosema, but this is Chris Guyana. So you mix them together, you plant them together, after planting them together, then you harvest. There you harvest both protein and carbohydrates. This hay is going to be one of the rich in protein and carbohydrates for animals. It's like you're serving both beef, matoke, and karo at once,
okay,
in human beings. In animals, you're serving both protein these beans here and carbohydrates. Even when you're going to sell, a bell that has these legumes and carbohydrates is going to be expensive compared to when you plant rice only. That is number one. Number two, it's a cover crop. It's fixing nitrogen in the soil so that your soils are going to be enriched with fertile soils. Then, and again, the herbage is going to be a lot. Imagine the protein is so, the herbage is a lot. So when I'm going to get my hay, I slash everything. I slash everything, pack it, and sell it. Yes. Yeah, that's the thing now. That's the thing. So protein, so I'm encouraging most of the farmers to plant these things, both the silage, rather the hay, mixed with the beans, so that they can have the good protein supply at once. The good thing with this zero grazing, as I've seen, compared to that free range, I'm selling the manure. Remember, we started it saying the comparative advantage. Don't ever do a business where you don't have comparative advantage. We are in urban areas. People are looking for manure. Imagine if you're in free range, where you're going to put this manure. As you have seen outside, I'm having 100 bags of manure collected from this, from just only 6 cows. Each bag is 10,000. But probably by one of that is 1 m after 2.5-3 months. Okay, so I'm selling this manure. That is advantage number one, which you're not going to get from free range, number one. Number two, how are you going to collect? Because you have seen our biogas. Biogas, the main component is the poopoo, the cow dung.
Yes.
For someone who is on free range, a cow poopoo's here, then after a kilometer, after, where are you going to? So it's here to collect. It's easy to collect urine, easy to collect the cow dung, and use it. Use manure, use the biogas. It's very easy. Someone who is on free range is not going to have that. Then the comfortability of the farmer, the comfortable. You know, we don't want to take farmers as my grandfather in 1998. We are in the modernity where we are seated. You know, I've ever seen this. I'm seated in the club. We are talking. I'm going to have my tea here. The comfortability, the ease of doing farming, because labor. Where are you going to get all these workers? The rain, you're going to have most of the workers moving, going. But here, I normally have my workers, they're here up to 6 years, up to 7 years. Why? The comfortability. In a real language of yours, they call it swag. There is swag, swaggerific in this kind of environment. You sit, seated here, you look after your cows very well, the clean environment, the therapy, and you enjoy when you're doing, which is not in free range.
Okay.
Yes.
Finally, how does a man like you work closely with the woman? So I know that there are people that run businesses, and in most cases, the men take the lead, and the women never have any idea. So in case anything happens to the man, the business disappears.
Wow.
How do you handle yours?
I like that question. Really, we sat together with my wife after watching other people, family businesses. We saw Jessa doing as a family, we saw this St. Lawrence schools working as a family. I think family business is one of the best things farmers in Uganda are lacking. For example, here, in case I'm not around, my wife is going to be here. And we also taught our young kids, in case of anything, they're also going to be there. We are doing it as a family business. She's here, I'm there. Now, the advantage is in that you're employed. You're employed here. Instead of scattering the resources, she has a shop in town, then you have, you know, but all the kamani, all whatever it is, collected here. You get your money here, you feed, you don't have any transport that you're going to transport, to go to work and here. So we are looking everything, most of our things here. Number two, there is posterity. There is this kind of continuation. That in case there is somebody, maybe I'm sick, maybe I'm dead, maybe something.
Out of the country or something like that, yes.
Your wife is going to be there. In case she's not there, I'm here. Then also, there is love. You know, take a center or whatever. Your wife is here. I'm here.
That's right.
We are working together, yeah. That's together. That's continuation of love. What people, actually, you're laughing, but that's a very good point.
Yes.
Most of the people, you find the wife is working in Kabong or Abim. The man is working in Mbarara. They spend the whole month, the whole year, and they call it marriage. That's not marriage. Okay, that's not marriage. Marriage is when you're seated looking at your wife. Your wife is still looking at you. Mm. So that you look after your family, you look after your kids. What is lacking? That thing is lacking.
Yeah.
Most of the, we started this family between me and my wife. We take care of each other.
Okay.
We groom our kids very easy. We eat together. We love together. We bond together as love. So I could say one number one fun is love. There is love when you're working with your wife.
Okay.
We are looking forward, really, first of all, that in 3 years from now, we want to put accommodation. Many people, they are asking us, we see Nje, for us, many guys are calling us from Sudan, from Kenya, from where. They want to come, but where are we going to? So we want to put accommodation facility where people could come and sleep and enjoy milk and see the fruits. You have not seen our fish, then we are putting bees. So number one, we want to put accommodation here. Number two, we want to build a very big workshop house where people could come and get training, get advisory centers. Then number three, we want to do agro-tourism where people could come. Because not everyone, by the way, is interested in your animals, in your people. There are some sons of the rich, daughters of the rich who come and see cows.
Yeah.
They have never seen cows. They're in Kororo. They normally see cows on TV. We want this agro-tourism where we can charge a fee. People come and see cows, they see goats, they eat fish, they relax. That's the new Uganda.
Okay.
So those are some of our projects. I think 3 to 10 years, we shall be there.
Thank you very much.
Hello, I'm called Jole Utsinje. I'm a co-partner here at Itungo Pastures. I'm very happy to work with my husband. We are enjoying working together at Itungo Pastures. First of all, the beauty about working together as a family, when one of you is sick, another one will always be there. You cannot like close the business. Then also it gives you time, not like where you're employed. When you're employed and maybe you have like a party, you may fail like to get that time to go and go to the party. But here you make sure one stays to run the business, then another one goes to the party. Then also ladies, I would advise ladies especially, because they are men who usually come here complaining that their partners don't like what they are doing. Please, I would advise listeners there, as you find when like some ladies like to work together, or you find men when they are not like interested in what the other partner is doing. I would like, and I would like to advise them, at least you get interested in what your partner is doing. Because when you're like employed somewhere and maybe, God forbid, you die, your job cannot like be inherited. But when it's a family business and one person is gone, another one will always take it to learn. Then also the kids. Please, parents, try to introduce the kids to the businesses that you're doing. So that when you start teaching them to run the businesses, especially like this farming we are doing, or it may even be like a hotel, it may be a tourism, any business, make sure you don't like do it alone. Introduce your family. Let your wife or your husband or your children or your partner be also introduced to the business so that you can do it together.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right. So in terms of finances, you know, it's one of the biggest things families have. I don't know how much my husband earns. Maybe he's spending money on women, things like that. How does working with your husband feel knowing what has come in and how you're spending the finances?
Now the fortunate part of it here, I'm the accountant. So we give ourselves salaries. And so we sat together, I and my husband, and we agreed, of course, we get some certain percentage and we put it on like a family account on what we are supposed to do. And then also we leave allowances to ourselves, because I have my interests as a lady, for example, like I need to work on my hair, I need to paint my nails. And also my husband has got his interests. So we put some percentage where all of us, we put on like a family account, and then we leave a small percentage to do what he or me, I wish to do.
As you can see, if you have a spouse and you own a business, it's all about discipline and the rest will be history because you're guaranteed success. Now, in our personal finance this week, we start a month-long journey on money growth ideology with Frank Kapshenga.
Hello viewers, my name is Frank Kapshenga. I'm happy to be hosted today at the business show and in this specific segment about personal finance. I am the administration manager at Vision Group and I'm also an author and publisher. My first book is entitled Smart Career Pursuit and also basically seeks to inspire and encourage professionals on their journey or their career journey to make sure that they make smart decisions. Specifically for today's program, I've got a message that I want to pass on that I believe would go a long way to support us on our career journeys, on our business journeys, and with a view of making preparing us to have good financial, make good financial decisions, but really be prepared to be able to manage our finances as we seek to make better lives at individual and personal level. Now, my topic for today's session is the money growth ideology. Money growth ideology. But to start with, I know that it usually seems to be obvious that you know what money is. But money is a current medium of exchange. Current because it keeps changing. Seasons come and you find that we are now using different means of exchange to do transactions. So it is basically a current medium of exchange. And so growth is increase from one level to another. And so why I call this today's topic the money growth ideology is because each of us would want to be at a greater level in terms of our possession, in terms of having money. You'd want to have, if you have 10 million today, your desire is to have 20 million tomorrow, or 15, or a billion, or name it. But that you can be, this can be at an individual level or at a company level. So the money growth ideology is very important. So how do we manage to be able to establish ourselves to have a proper money ideology? And then I'll also define the term ideology. Ideology is a system within which you as an individual operate, or a company, or a government. So a government might have an economic ideology within which they plan to grow the economy of the company, of the government, sorry. Now, when you come to a company, an entity of a company, they also have their ideology within which they grow the funds of the company. Now, at an individual level, we also need to have our own individual money growth ideology. What are the systems within which you'd want to see your money grow from one stage to another? That is very important. Because it's not just a matter of desiring to have more money and so it comes. No, that desire will need to be supported by a system in place. But how does that system get established? Now, there are factors that we need to consider to be able to have a robust money growth ideology. To start with, I'd want to bring your attention to the word love, the love for money. You want to grow, so you establish a system. But how do you now How do you roll out this system? This system needs to be established on love, the love for money. I know that in most cases and a number of circles, we get to know, and also in the Bible is mentioned that the love for money is the beginning of all trouble. But I want to tell you that in the economic sense, if you want to grow your money, the love for money is not a problem. Because we cannot shy away from it. We all love this money. And we should love it so much that we will now start to care for it. So the love for money is not a problem. The problem is the abuse of it. So are you loving money? If you are, that's very good. But be keen to identify the tendencies that will lead you to its abuse. That's where the problem lies. Now, when you love somebody, you will make all means and put measures in place to care for them. That is in bringing the human perspective. But now this is money. So if you love the money, now you'll also need to put in place the systems we talked about that will care for it to ensure its growth. And that will become your money growth ideology. So the money growth ideology becomes your foundation to grow your personal finance. You may know so many lucrative places where you can invest your money, but if you don't have a proper money growth ideology, you are simply cheating yourself and you're wasting time somehow, because yes, you might get this money and you will not see how it may not last with you for the longer time that you perceive, or it may not meet your purpose. So I would like to encourage us to establish the money growth ideology within our operations. So how do you care for it? So caring for it means that you'll want to build this money shelter, get for it a bank account, open a bank account, there you store it.
The Uganda shilling remained marginally stable as the week opened. This activity remained limited on the demand side after a long weekend. Here is the Forex and Money Market Report. That's it for this week's edition of The Business Show. Thank you very much for making time from the team and I. Enjoy your week and your weekend. But also remember to catch the repeat of this show every Saturday at 9 a.m. Good night.